Good morning, everybody, and thank you for joining us this morning. I know it's been about a week that we've been working on this main break, and it's I think it's appropriate now to give you an update on what's happening. So I just want to report that we continue to work on the damaged pipe. Is a 42-inch diameter pipeline, a very, very critical transmission main in our water system. And I'm glad to report at this time, the water system is able to handle this without this 42-inch main in service because of the damage to the pipe. But we are watching the system very carefully, and encourage people not to really use water wisely. Don't waste it. It's a precious resource of our community. We're monitoring the water system, so we're able to hold at this point and continue to provide service without interruption. Back to the main break. What you have here on my left is actually a photo of the damage. So one of the things, our approach here was, this is our largest pipe in our system. What we did was cut a hole, once we were able to excavate down deep, and we went down over 16 feet to get to the top of the pipe. The pipe is actually encased in a concrete, reinforced concrete jacket to protect the pipe. We had to break that jacket open. It's about 1 foot thick of concrete around the pipe. Our crews broke that pipe, broke that jacket open, and actually exposed the steel pipe. And what we did was we cut a hole in that pipe. It's quarter inch steel plate. We cut a hole in it and actually lowered a camera into the pipe. And this is the photo that we got from that camera. We did that because we wanted to understand the nature of the damage to the pipe, and that would guide us on how to repair it. So what we have right now, what you see in this photo, is actually a hole because of the horizontal direction drilling tool that was actually reaming out the hole that was being dug under the freeway. That tool came into contact with our steel pipe. And it kind of ground through the one inch concrete jacket and started to damage our pipe. So this may look like a large hole, but really the dimensions are approximately 6 inches by about 10 inches or a foot. But a hole that big in our transmission main is serious business. And we have to repair it before we can get the pipe back into service. What we did was we looked at, we have two choices to approach the repair. Normally what we would do on repairs of a pipe of this type or pipes in our system, we dig a really big hole, we'd get to the outside of the pipe, we'd expose the damaged area of the pipe, and then weld on a repair plate onto that hole. But in this case, remember the pipe is like over 16 feet deep. And it's right next to the freeway on-ramp structure. So our ability to dig down and get to this location is really kind of limited at this point. It would be very challenging. So what we did, decided to do it to explore the option of repairing the pipe from inside the pipe. Now I would say normally, most of our water mains, you can't fit a person into the pipe. But in this case, because the pipe is almost 4 feet in diameter, we found a welding company that specializes in marine welding, and they were willing to actually enter the small limited space, it is a little less than 4 feet in diameter, and actually try to weld the repair plate from the inside of the pipe. What we hope to do is have that being done this weekend, and by next week we'll know if we're successful or not in getting the pipe repaired from within. However, I want to just caution you, as main breaks of this type occur, it is kind of an unfolding situation that we encounter different things that poses challenges. So should the repair from the inside not be successful, then we'll have to go back to our more standard approach of repairing pipe like this, which is excavate deep down into the ground, expose the damaged pipe on the outside, and try to repair it from the outside. That will take longer to accomplish. If we can get the pipe repaired from the inside, that will really help shave off time in getting this pipeline back into service. And our priorities, I want to reiterate our priorities again for this situation is, one, Number one, repair the pipe and get the water flowing through it again to supply the community of Honolulu from Kalihi all the way to Hawaikai. Number two, we want to also be able to open up the freeway, because right now we have one lane of the westbound lanes of the freeway, H201, right there near Fort Shafter closed because of this main break. We want to get that reopened as soon as we can. So those remain our objectives. We continue to work at it. If the repair from the inside is possible and we're successful, then the next step we'll do is try to repair the concrete jacket. But remember, the concrete jacket is encircles the pipe. Rather than trying to dig down to repair it, we're going to try to do something called jet grouting, which is actually drill small diameter holes deep into the ground near the jacket and actually pump cement grout in there to fill that void that was created by this horizontal directional drilling, and try to get the concrete encasement around the pipe repaired. Once that's done, what we're going to do is we're also going to look at over the next week to actually flush and clean out the pipe. And actually test the water in the pipe to make sure it meets our drinking water standards. Part of the process too, in the flushing, we're going to discharge large amounts of water into a nearby canal while we're flushing. But we also want to get any kind of debris that might be in there because of this damage out of that pipe before we put it back in service. Now then, after that, we're going to proceed to actually repair the highway and get the freeway restored to full service. The timeline for this is we are going to be into July. I know it's been over a week now since the main break occurred, but it looks like with the work that we see coming up that we're going to be well into maybe the middle or latter part of July to finally complete the work. So we appreciate everybody's patience. Hopefully the freeway traffic hasn't been too bad during rush hour, and Shelley from the Department of Transportation will give us some updated information on that. But remember that we're continuing to work very quickly and to try to get this repair completed. It also has been a good team effort because we couldn't do this without the assistance of the State Department of Transportation. We're impacting their freeway. Also the City Department of Transportation Services, because this has an effect also on the city streets and also the buses. Our other partner has been the Army. We've included the Army in the discussions and meetings to take a very collaborative approach to getting this 42-inch main repaired. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Shelley from the State Department of Transportation to give us an update on the traffic situation. Shelley?
Thank you, Ernie, and thank you to you and your team for doing such a fabulous job in getting the water system restored. So we have been monitoring this area as also part of our assessment of traffic conditions during the COVID-19 emergency. And on this route, we're still seeing under 18% of the average daily volumes from 2019, pre-COVID. And monitoring this route and the alternate routes, such as H1, we are seeing the PM peaks are flowing well. There's about maybe 500 fewer vehicles on H201 at Fort Shafter after the break, and thank you to the media partners for getting the word out on this, because people are listening. And the flow on H1 is still looking good, so that is absorbing some of the additional westbound traffic there. So thank you again to everyone.
Thank you, Shelley. Before I bring up Tai Fukumitsu from the City Department of Transportation Services, I was kind of remiss. I should have mentioned what are the lane closures during this time when we're working to repair the 42-inch transmission main. So right now there is always going to be, normally there are four lanes westbound on the H201 at Fort Shafter at that location. But because basically our excavation to our 42-inch main has dug up one of the Malcolmost lane. That lane remains closed for the duration of the repair. There are currently three lanes open, and what we're having done here is actually from 4 a.m. to about 8 p.m. each night, 7 days a week, we're going to keep three lanes open westbound. Outside of those hours, to work on the repair, and if necessary, we may need to close additional lanes, maybe another additional lane. So there might be times outside of the 4 a.m. to 8 p.m. window that an additional lane might be closed because we need to get material and equipment in there to try to expedite this repair. So that'll continue until the repair is completed. And again, we hope to hope that everything works out smoothly, and we just encourage, you know, if you can keep us in your prayers and have good thoughts for us, that we're going to be successful and get through this very challenging main break. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Tai Fukumitsu from the Department of Transportation Services. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you, Ernie. Aloha, everyone. In conjunction with our partners, the State Department of Transportation and the Board of Water Supply, the city continuously is monitoring our roadways for the traffic diversion due to the water main break. This is typical. This is not a special event that we're doing just for this water main break. Anytime we have any type of emergencies or other water main breaks, we'll always do this. So we've been monitoring the roadways, and exactly what Shelley had mentioned, that although there is a lane closure on the freeway, we really don't see traffic picking up that much. It is just about still normal or below traffic levels. What we're seeing is traffic is flowing throughout the Honolulu area, and that's through King Street, Barretania, Dillingham, Nimitz Highway. But we are constantly monitoring, and if timing changes need to be made to account for the additional traffic flow, we immediately do the timing changes.
Well, thank you, Ty. I'm kind of getting forgetful here, I'm sorry. And we'll be issuing a press release after this news conference. I just want to mention also, the on-ramp, Kaua Street on-ramp was actually closed for a bit now because of the repair work, but it has since been reopened. But like the lanes on the freeway, there may be times that we need to get equipment up there to expedite the repair, especially when we start to jet grout, cement grout into the ground. We may need to close that off-ramp or kind of move the traffic on the off-ramp more Mauka. But right now, the Kaua Street on-ramp to the freeway is reopened. I'm open for questions. We have our team here, and we're available for any questions that you might have.
With the 4th of July weekend coming up next week, are there any preparations for that?
What we're going to do is basically keep the same mode of operations in terms of the lane closures. We will be working through, our crews will continue to work through the 4th of July weekend. It's not a holiday for us right now. And basically our operations are 24/7. So we have multiple crews coming in shifts to do work on the repair. So traffic-wise, the closures outside the window of 4 a.m. to 8 p.m. will still be in place. 4 a.m. to 8 p.m. westbound will be three lanes open at all times. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. The diameter, which is the distance from one side of the pipe to the other side measured horizontally across it, is 42 inches in diameter. 4 feet is 48 inches, so we're a little shy of 4 feet. It is almost 4 feet in diameter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's at 42 inches, so it's a little 6 inches shy of 4 feet. And the size of the hole, again, is about this tear in the pipe is around 5 or 6 inches wide by about 10 to 12 inches long. There is another area of damage nearby. It's basically a little puka through the pipe. So we think some of the directional drilling tool, one of the teeth punctured through the pipe at that point. So there is actually two places of damage.
So you had mentioned earlier that the work will continue through the month of July.
At this time, I wish I could give you a firm date, but I don't have a firm date. Right now, we're kind of looking at targeting the middle, maybe third week in July to get everything cleaned up, reopened completely. But I just also want to caution you, with the nature of this type of work, there are going to be times where we're going to encounter unknowns that we could not tell because it's deep underground. And we have to adjust and adapt. So throughout this whole process, it's been one of really, it's a kind of a journey of discovery, learning what the conditions are, and also adapting to what we discover. So this weekend is going to be very important for us. You know, we are going to look at, for the first time in my career with the Board of Water Supply, it's that we've tried to actually repair a steel concrete cylinder steel pipe like this from welding from the inside of the pipe. And I think it's only possible because of the large diameter. If it's a smaller pipe, we would not be able to get the person with the equipment in there. We were fortunate enough to find a marine welding company that was willing to do this work and could do it safely because this is a very tight, confined space. Are there any other questions?
What's the worst-case scenario if this fails from the inside? How long would it take?
So if it fails from the inside, if we're not successful here, and I'm telling you what I know at the moment, is that we're going to have to jet grout a larger area outside, area that we've already got shoring in place. Because remember, the hole is right now at least 16 feet deep, and to be able to safely send my crew into the hole, they have to be able to get in there and work on the pipe without the risk of the excavation or the sides of the trench collapsing and burying them, which is a hazard. So what happened is the area of this damage, unfortunately, we thought it was within the area that we had shored and installed the shoring, but it's just outside of that area. So what we have in place is there's a tall tower there right alongside the freeway, just past this location where the break is, work is occurring. That's a batching plant to actually produce the cement grout that'll be injected into the ground outside of the excavation. So what we're gonna have to do is jet grout to stabilize the soil and also stabilize the footing of the freeway that's right there, the on-ramp. Then we can go in and excavate down, if we have to do that, all the way to expose the whole pipe itself, including the bottom of the pipe. I forgot to mention, that's a good point, this tear or gash in the pipe by the directional drilling tool is actually located near the bottom of the pipe. So that means, you know, remember the pipe in this location is completely encased in what we call a concrete jacket, which is to protect the pipe. It's at least a foot thick. So we're going to have to excavate down deep enough, be able to break the jacket from underneath and expose the pipe enough so we could weld the steel plate over the hole, over the damage area. If we have to do it from the outside, I'm not going to say we can do it faster. It is going to be a slow but process, but it's important that we proceed with the work safely. I do not want to put our workers or contractors that are working for us on this at risk. Safety is number one. It's very important. We want to get this water main back in service for our community. We want to open up the highway, but safety is paramount for us. I think it'll probably end up probably later in July. if we have to do the worst case scenario of going from the outside. If we can do it from the inside, then we're looking someplace maybe the middle or third week in July. Latter part of July. Yeah. Remember, we are working 24 hours a day. It may not look like it at times, but you know, our staff is working on this 24 hours a day. So by this weekend, we'll know if the repair of the pipe from the inside, something innovative for us, works. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, then you'll see us proceeding with jet grouting and starting to dig a bigger hole and a deeper hole. Any other questions, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah, thank you so much. You know, we'll keep you informed because this is going to take time to get done. So periodically, I appreciate the stations coming out, the media coming out to this press conference. We find this is actually a kind of an easier way, a more efficient way to give you an update on what's happening. And we want to keep you informed and keep our community informed. So mahalo, aloha, and mahalo.